students, welcome to the chemistry sessions once again. So, have you revised the concepts for isomerism? So, we have covered the neat pattern exercise. Now, let's move on to the JE main pattern exercise for the isomerism. So, you need to have a good hold over the concept. So, let us just try to solve the question number one. So, it seems to be a bit, confusing. But it is actually very, very simple. So that is how the kind of questions which come up in the IIT mains. So you need not to worry about that. We are going to solve it. The absolute configuration of this very molecule we need to find out. Just as what we did in the case of isomerism, in the case of assigning the RS configurations for the simple molecules, that means having only one chiral carbon, that is the only type of the procedure over here. You need to just find out the number of chiral carbons, that is the first step, and then you just assign the configurations with the same kind of procedure, with the same rules that we have followed. So let's just take up the example here. There is COOH, OH, Cl, CH3. So these are the groups, these are the different kinds of groups which are attached. So what are the chiral carbons? Here we have got two chiral carbons. That means number one, this very carbon is actually attached with four different groups. I mean to say that this very group will be treated as a whole, as one. That means I've got four attachments different. Again, if I look onto this very carbon, here I've got again one, two, three different, along with the fourth one. So that is what the fourth one is. That means two different kind of chiral carbons here over here. So let me just mark out the chiral carbons here. These are the two chiral carbons that we have got. Now, there is a very simple method. Again, we need to assign the configurations. So, as per the priority order, as what we have did earlier, so what will be the priority order? It would be as per the atomic mass or atomic number. So, in the case of, as I told you, the priority orders . So for the molecules, I need to have either atomic on the basis of atomic mass or on the basis of atomic number. So in the case of isotopes, we need to consider the atomic mass because the isotopes are different, are having different kinds of neutrons. So the atomic mass will be different in the case of isotopes, whereas in the case of normal molecules, normal elements, atomic number always differ. That is, the number of electrons are always different. But that's not the case in the case of isotopes. Isotopes have got the similar kind of electrons. So that is what we have discussed. So this was considered in the terms of isotopes if we are discussing. And this is for the general elements. So I need to consider on the basis of atomic number. So that is how we are going to assign the priorities over here. So COOH, OH. So if I try to consider all the four groups, which will be the number one? The number one will be, let me just compare the first atoms. So the first atoms, if I go this ways. In the case of first, comparing the first very atoms, I've got oxygen here, I've got a carbon, and here as well I've got a carbon. So oxygen will be on the higher priority. That means number one to be assigned to this very group. So let's move on to now the two carbons, two remaining carbons. I need to assign the priorities between the two. So if I move on to this very carbon and this very carbon, similar kind of atoms. But if I move on to the next, what do I have? So if I move next here, as we all know that COOH, this is nothing but the carboxylic group, and it must be treated as a carbon attached to oxygen, an oxygen attached to a carbon. So that is how we are going to deal with the C double bond O, as we have discussed earlier, and finally the OH. Now, the first very carbons are of similar types. Next atom would be the oxygen as per the treatment. But over here, if you look, the next atom is chlorine. That means higher side. That means the priority. Chlorine is always on the priority. It has got higher atomic number as compared to the oxygen over here. So I hope you all have got it that this very group over here, this whole group which is treated as one group attached to the carbon atom, this very carbon atom, it must be treated as two. So that is two. And for this, naturally it will be three. So what do I have? One, two and three. So that is how we are going in this case. So let me just draw this very curve again. Okay now. So it's two already. So one, two, three. So that is how we are going to have a curve. That means clockwise direction R. But if you notice, the hydrogen is on the horizontal. So you need to invert the configuration as we did before. So instead of R, it would be S. So that is for the carbon number. If I try to have a proper chain, if I try to have a proper numbering of the carbons during the formation of the word root, so I'll be numbering the carboxylic acid carbon as 1 and followed by 2. So I have 1, 2, 3 and 4. That is how we are going to number the carbons. So on to the 2, I have got S. So can you see any kind of options? Yes, I have got two options showing 2S. So that means I've eliminated the two possibilities. Let's just move on to the next. So here, if I consider this very carbon, chlorine, C and these very groups. So out of all, definitely the chlorine will be on the higher side, will be on the priority one. Now comparing this carbon and these very groups. So carbon-carbon, if I move here like that, so the carbon-carbon would be similar kind. Let's move on to the next atom. So the next atom would be oxygen, but over here there is no kind of next atom. That means this very group again will be on the higher side. That means 2 to assign this group and number 3 to this. 1, 2, 3. So that is how we are going to have. That is anti-clockwise direction means S, but over here the hydrogen is on the horizontal. So again what we are getting is the inverted configuration, that is R. So we get R and the carbon number is third, so 3R. Is there any kind of option? Definitely, yes. A is the answer. So I hope you all have got the answer over here. So that is how we are going to assign the different kind of configurations, different kind of RS configurations to our complicated molecules having more than one chiral carbons. So I hope you all have got the idea. Let's move on to the next very question. So let me just rub this off. A very, very simple question this is. So the number of stereoisomers obtained by the bromination of trans-2-butene. So I need to brominate what? Trans-2-butene. So that is, I need to have a bromination of this very compound. So in the case of bromination, what is the product? So I need to brominate this. Bromination in the presence of what? In the presence of, I can say, the sunlight. So that is how it is going to be. Or they haven't mentioned about what kind of a bromination are they performing. So we are considering the simple bromination. So over here, I need to have the number of isomers. So first of all, just try to form the product out of it. Try to form the product of the bromination and then we'll get our answer. So over here, if you see what is bromination, I need to brominate. That means this very double bond. If I try to consider the free radical mechanism, so we are considering the free radical. What do we get? Twice of Br free radical we get. That is all we know. And over here as well, we get two free radicals. That means something like this. So that is how we are getting the radicals. So either the bromine gets attached here or the bromine gets attached here. So these are the only possibilities. If the bromine attached got attached here, I get what? I get something like this. And if the other bromine again comes up, on to this very free radical, what do I get? A dibromo product we get. And as per the stereochemistry, if you consider, it would be definitely this very stereochemistry. That means it must be an antiproduct. So, I would like to discuss one more reaction over here. If I am not considering the free radical mechanism, but the bromination in the presence of CCl4, that is what we have done under the category of test for unsaturation. So, this is test for unsaturation. So, in this very thing, we always get what kind of a product? We always get an anti kind of a product. So, here again I would be getting a similar kind of answer, just like this. That means in either of the cases I'll be getting a similar kind of an isomer. That means it must be arranged anti, because this has got minimum steric repulsions. So that means every kind of a reaction is pointing out towards just one option. That means one kind of a stereoisomer we'll be getting over here. That means the number of stereoisomers obtained on the bromination for the trans-2-butene is always 1. They have not specified what kind of a bromination is it. So I have considered as many as I can. So you can also consider it is not definitely the anti-Markovnikovs or Markovnikovs. So you need not go into the detail, just a simple bromination you had to perform. So that is how we are getting the answer. Answer is one kind of stereoisomer. I hope you all have got this. So let's move on to the next very question. Now, here comes up the question for conformations. So it's a pretty interesting question. You need to perform a rotation over here. So if you read the question carefully, there is a compound which is given over here, and this is what? This is the Newman projection, as we have done it before. So that is nothing but the Newman projection. So I hope you all have actually recalled the concept. Now, C2 is rotated anti-clockwise 120 degrees. That means what? What is C2? C2 is this very carbon which is pointing out towards you. That is how the C2 is. And the C3, as they have mentioned, C2, C3. The C3 is the carbon which is behind it. That means the bigger circle they are talking about. So I hope you all have got this, which is C2 and which is C3. Now we need to perform the action what they are asking. So C2 is rotated anti-clockwise 120 degrees. That means they are actually rotating the C2. That means this very, the carbon which is pointing out towards you, they are rotating this very carbon at an angle of, what is the angle? It's 120 degrees. About C2-C3 bond. That means naturally it would be a C2-C3 bond, something like this. And they, let us just say that this very carbon over here, which is pointing out towards you, and I've got another carbon which is pointing out towards me. So you need to rotate the first very carbon, that means this C2. So that is how you are going to rotate it. So you need to rotate it at 120 degrees, that is the angle. So how, what kind of a conformation, what kind of a conformer? Resulting conformer is nothing but the conformation is. So they are asking about the type of conformation obtained after the rotation of 120 degrees. So what do we have here? We have got CH3 over here that belongs to the carbon which we need to rotate. So if I rotated 120 degrees, that means this angle is nothing but 120 degrees, this whole angle. This very angle as well. So if we rotated 120 degree anti-clockwise, so just be careful while actually reading out the question. So anti-clockwise they are asking, that means I need to go in this direction. So if I rotated 120 degree, that means cover up 120 degree angle, what do I get? I get CH3 over here. Again this H will be shifted onto here. And this very H will be shifted on to here. So that is how, sorry, over here. So that is what we are going to get. So let us just draw the structure after the rotation. What do we get? So it would be CH3 would be here, H here, and the other H here. Now let's just arrange the remaining ones. So that is what we are getting. This is the kind of structure obtained after the rotation. So now, can you guess what kind of a conformation is it? So we all know what is the fully eclipsed or eclipsed conformation. That is when the bulkier groups are actually lying parallel to each other. So over here they are not parallel. That means they have got a slight angle in between, that is 60 degrees. Also, it is not staggered because the conformation which was earlier given in the question, that is only the staggered. So we have eliminated the staggered possibility, we have eliminated the eclipsed. What is partially eclipsed now? So partially eclipsed is also overlapping, or I can say the parallel connection, but the parallel connection would be somehow what? It would be if CH3 is lying parallel to H. That means it is not fully repulsion, it is not having fully steric repulsions, but a partial steric repulsion. When the repulsion is fully steric, when is the repulsion fully steric? If I move this group CH3 and the two CH3 are lying parallel to each other. So that is what the difference between the fully eclipsed and partially eclipsed is. So let me just write out the fact, if the two CH3 are lying almost parallel, that is fully eclipsed, and if one CH3 is lying here, okay. Let me just draw that for you. If this is one CH3, if the other is parallel to each other, that means they are lying next to or opposite to each other. So that is what fully eclipsed is. If I say about the partially, partially is what? Partially is something like this. If I have got CH3 over here and the parallel one is this. So that is how the partial eclipsed is. And what? The two hydrogens. So that is what it is. Now we are left with one. That is nothing but the gauche. Whenever there is 60 degree angle between the bulky groups, which we have represented over here, so that means what? That is nothing but the gauche conformation. So we have eliminated all the possibilities and we get our answer. I hope that is very well clear to you. You need to have proper structures in your mind that what all these conformations are. So let's just move ahead to the next question. So what does the next question say? Let me just rub that off. So it says, which of the following geometrical isomers, sorry, which of the following compounds will exhibit geometrical isomerism? Now again, the question of geometrical isomerism has come up. What are the conditions? You need to have a double bond. So first of all, we need to have CC bonds, because in order to have a restricted rotation, what is second? Second must be on either side of the double bonds. You must be having different kinds of groups. So different groups on either side of double bond. So these are the two conditions, two prime conditions for a molecule to exhibit what? Exhibit geometrical isomerism. So let us just try to draw the structures, we'll get our answer. It's very, very simple question over here. So I've got one phenyl 2-butene. I need to have bute, and it is on to the second position where the ene has been attached. That means on the second carbon, I've got it. I'm not mentioning the hydrogens over here. We can also mention the hydrogens. So I've got one phenyl. Okay, on to the first carbon, I've got phenyl. That means something like this. Now, let me just complete the hydrogens over here. H2, H, H, H3. So that is what it is. So can you arrange these in a cis trans conformation? So there is a double bond. Yes, there is a double bond. Do I get different groups on either side of the double bond? So let us just check. I have got this double bond attached with the carbon having this very group. And what else? This carbon having one more hydrogen. That means that is how what we are getting. CH2, C6H5. I'm writing this phenyl as this. And a hydrogen. Can you represent this very thing like this? Definitely yes. Now, I have got CH3. And one more hydrogen over here to represent. So that is what it is. Now, moving on to the second one. I've got 3-phenyl-1-butene. That means, 3-phenyl means, again I am drawing the butene here, but it is on the one position, that is the double bond. So 1-butene and 3-phenyl, that means 1, 2, 3. I've got it here, C6H5. So if I try to complete the bonds, the hydrogens, H, CH and CH3. Now, can you arrange it? So let us just have a geometry over here. Try to have a geometry. Two hydrogens. And here what do we have? We have got CH, C6H5 along with a CH3. And a hydrogen extra. So that is what we have. That is the number second. What do I have? 2-phenyl-1-butene. Let's draw that. 2-phenyl. 2-phenyl-1-butene. So I've got, okay, 1-butene. That means this double bond is arranged over here. And 2-phenyl, that means a C6H5 lying here. C6H5. Let us just complete the hydrogens again. So I hope you all are following up. So that is how we are going to have it. Let us just again arrange it. So it would be, so some of you might have got the answer by now. So it is 2-phenyl, okay. So it would be something like this, CH2. An ethyl group along with a phenyl group attached, C6H5. And moving on to the last one, very last. So what it is 1,1-diphenyl-1-propene. So it is, I need 1-propene, 1,1-diphenyl, that means C6H5, and that is what we have. That is the last one. So let us just quickly observe the options now. So we have got the structures for here. So definitely it fulfills the condition number one, having a double bond. But the different type of groups that we have. Do we have different types of groups on either side of the double bond? No. Here these are two similar. That means this is not the possibility. If I move on to this way. So here what do we have? Again, this side has got the different groups, but over here it is not to be considered as an option. So if I move on to here, again we can have a very pretty much clarity about it, that these are the two similar groups attached. That means no kind of a cis trans representation. Now let's move on to the first one that we took. Here what do we have? We have got one group, we have got two groups on the same side. That means these are different groups. We can exhibit cis trans isomerism. If I've got CH3 and H, again the different kind of groups, again cis trans isomerism exhibition capability. So I hope that is clear to you. We have got the answer over here, that is number one. So you need to have the conditions, you need to have the logics to get the answer. Let's move on to quickly the next question. So before moving on to the question, just first note this down. So let's just quickly discuss the next question. What do we have next? So it is a pretty simple question. The question of enolic form. That means what do we have over here? I need to find out the enolic form of acetone. So it's a very simple method. So first let us just have the structure here. That is acetone. What will be the enolic form? So let me just represent this in another way. The hydrogen. And that is how you are going to have an interaction which will result in the enolic form. That is the tautomerism that we are doing. So this is keto form and we get the enol form. Pretty simple. Now we need to count what? The number of sigma bonds, the number of pi bonds, as well as the lone pairs. So you need to find out that. Now let's just try to count the number of pi bonds. How many pi bonds do you see in the enol form? Only one. So that is only one pi bond. So how many options do we have for one pi bond? We have eliminated the two possibilities here. That means this and this. So we have got these two as the possibilities. Let's just try to count the number of sigma bonds here. So how many sigma bonds? 3, 4, 5, in between these two, 6, 7. Mind it, do not count the pi bond over here. It's only one. So I've got 7. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 and 9. That means for the two hydrogens. So that is what we are getting. We are getting 9 sigma here, 1 pi. And what about the lone pairs over here? So 9 sigma bonds, 1 pi. Lone pairs are 2. Where are the lone pairs present? So the lone pairs are nothing but on the oxygen. So it's a pretty simple question. I hope you all have got it. So answer is number 1 for that. So let us just move on to the next question. What does the next question say? So I have, yes. Which of the following will have least hindered rotation about the carbon-carbon bond? So we know that where is the restricted rotation? Restricted rotation. So wherever there is a double bond, CC double bond, or maybe in fact a triple bond. So all these bonds are very strong. They have got p orbitals lying perpendicular to each other, and that is what result in the hindered rotation. So we all have studied about this, that the hindered rotation is always in double bonds, or we can have the triple bonds. It would be a very strong bond and I cannot rotate the molecule because then the orbitals will break, the bonds will break. So that is why it is known as the restricted rotation. Now, again, I need to find out in between these molecules that which will be having the hindered rotation and which will be not. So first, let us just discuss the ethane molecule. Ethane is this. Can you see any double or a triple bond? Not at all. So this molecule can have a lot many conformations. So I hope you remember the conformational isomerism. It is actually whenever there is no kind of a hindered rotation and the two bonds can easily rotate. So no hindered rotation. That means naturally this is the answer. But let us just try to discuss all the three remaining three. I've got ethylene. That means what is ethylene? A double bond over here. That means cannot get rotated, the bond will break. Acetylene means triple bonds, again cannot be rotated, the bond will break. Now let's have this very option. So you might be getting confused between the ethane and the hexachloroethane. So what is hexachloroethane? Instead of the 6 hydrogens, we have got 6 chlorines. So You might be saying that this is again a single bond, it can get rotated. Definitely it can get rotated. But if you look very carefully, I've got 6 chlorines attached, leading out to so much of steric repulsions. There will be so much of steric hindrances and repulsions that so much steric hindrance, that means the rotation will be almost impossible. So that is what we have in this very case. This very example is very important. Although it is having a single bond, but due to the steric repulsions, the rotation is not possible here. Rotation not possible. So I hope you all have got it. Our answer is A. So let us just move on to the next question. What we have in the next question? So we have got, okay, now an isomer of ethanol is, so it's a very, very simple question. If you know what is the detail about the structural isomerism, you will be cracking this question in a minute, or I can say in a few seconds. An isomer of ethanol. So what is ethanol first of all? That is the ethanol. So I am talking about the structural isomerism. That means having same molecular formula but different structural formula. So that is what structural isomerism is. So we need to check for the same molecular formula. Let us just have it, diethyl ether, that is CH3, CH2O, CH2, CH3. So definitely it cannot be the isomer because it has got 4 carbons and this has got only 2 carbons. So this is not the option. Let's move on to the acetone. So that is what acetone is. I've got 6 hydrogens here as well. I've got 6 hydrogens. 2 carbon atoms I have got. Okay, now. So the molecular formula, if you try to focus upon it, I've got 2 carbons, C2, H, how many H are there? 3, 4, 5, C2H5OH. So that is the, okay, I missed out one hydrogen over here. That means I've got C2H6O. So that is the molecular formula. And over here I've got no 2 carbons, but I've got 3 carbons over here. That means again it is violating the rule. And what about dimethyl ether? So let us just draw the structure for it. It is this. That means C2H6O. So finally we have got the answer. As per the definition, we have got the answer. And what are these kind of isomers known as? So this is behaving as an isomer with dimethyl ether. These are nothing but the functional isomers. That means different kind of function groups but same molecular formula. So these are functional isomers. So I hope you all have got it. Finally, the answer is D. So let's just move on to the next question. What do I have in the next question? Oh, wow. It is again the similar kind of an approach that we have followed up in the first question. That means finding out the absolute configuration. I've got 2 chiral carbons if you look very carefully. So let us just have the structure first in the form of Fischer projection. 2COOH at the very ends. That is how you represent. And over here if you look, OH is pointing out, is having a wedge. That means pointing out towards you. That means I need to represent this on the right and H to the left. In the second, OH is pointing out behind this board. That means away from you, it will be written here in the left. So let me just write that down again. OH and H. Now, It's pretty much simple. You need to again assign the configuration. So let us just try out. So again, O and this very group. So these are the two chiral carbons over here. O compared with C compared with this whole group. First priority will be given to O. So this carbon, and now moving on to this very carbon. Then what do I have? I have oxygen. I have oxygen. But it is further going on as we represent it as, we treat this as this. I hope you all remember. So it would be on a higher priority side definitely, 2. And this whole group will be 3. So I hope you all have got it. 1, 2, 3. That means clockwise direction should be R, but since the hydrogen is on the horizontal, it is S. So it will be S. Over here, again, number 1 given to this. Number 2, since the groups are similar, I need not to go into the detail. So 1, 2, and this will be 3. So it would be something like this. That means, again, clockwise direction, but I need to represent it as S. So that is how we are going to get the answer. It should be R, but it is S. So that is what the answer is. I hope you all have got it. Let's move on to the next very question. So it says, which one of the following conformations of cyclohexane is chiral? So it's a conceptual question. If you know the fact, you know the answer. You need to have the knowledge about the different conformations of cyclohexane. So what do we have? We have got twist boat, rigid, chair boat. So can you see a very slight incorrect thing over here? What is that incorrect thing? Rigid. That means this is no such kind of a conformation of cyclohexane. So rigid is no conformation. That is the first. Now, what about the remaining? Let us just draw the structures. This is the chair. That is chair. What is the boat one? That is the boat. And what do I have next? Twist boat. So that is boat. And the twist boat is? That is twist boat. Now, this very chair, it has got what? It is very much symmetrical. So this is symmetrical. It has got a plane of symmetry. Again, this board has got a plane of symmetry. It is also symmetrical. But twist board, if you can see, it is somewhat a distorted structure. It is somewhat unsymmetrical. So since this is unsymmetrical, it makes it what? It makes it a chiral compound. So this very conformation is chiral conformation, and that is what they are asking about. Chiral conformation, that means I need to find out which one is chiral. Rigid is no kind of a conformation, so we have eliminated that possibility. Again, it has got a plane of symmetry chair as well as the boat. So I've got the answer as twist boat. So I hope you all have got this very right. So let's have a look at the last question. What is the last question of this questionnaire round? So it says, yes, which one of the following molecules is expected to rotate the plane polarized light? So the molecule which is having a chiral carbon, let us just figure out what chiral carbons are here in the molecules. So I've got the first molecule, and there is the chiral carbon because all the four attachments are different. In the very B option, what do I have? I have got a chiral carbon over here. Definitely yes. If you see, again we have got a chiral carbon here, and again we have got a chiral carbon here. These are nothing but the dashed hydrogens that we have got. So I hope you are able to recognize this. Now, if you look on to this very carbon, this is what? This is glycine, this is the alpha amino acid, but this is non-chiral. Why? Because it has got two similar kind of groups attached. So this is not chiral. That means, let's look upon to all the remaining options. So if I go for the option number C, so let us just represent the option number C first, NH2, and at the end I am also writing NH2. Hydrogens to the left because they are having wedges, and phenyls to the right. That is how I am going to represent. So since these carbons are chiral, although they are chiral, but can you see a plane of symmetry? Yes, it is a meso compound. It is having a plane of symmetry over here, making it what? Making it achiral. That is a plane of symmetry. Also, if you observe in the B part, so there is the B part. If I try to have a structure for it, CH3, there is also CH3. And what do I have? SH in the middle, SHH. So that is what it is. Can you see again a plane of symmetry? Definitely yes. That is also a meso compound. I have got a plane of symmetry cutting from here. This would be the axis of cut. So I hope you all have got this. This is having a plane of symmetry again, making it what? Making it achiral. So we have finally got our answer, that is this. This is not having any kind of center of symmetry or plane of symmetry, and definitely it is having a chiral carbon. So that is our answer. So I hope you all have enjoyed the questionnaire and you have followed up. You need to revise all of these questions what we have done, and I'll be taking up another lot of questions in the next session. Till then, have a good day.